You remember.
Roll your stealth roll?
Game books, pencils, pizza, cheese puffs, and a hell of a lot of dice.
And the dragon woke up.
Roll for initiative.
This is the Roll for Initiative podcast, where 1E is the place to be.
Roll for Initiative podcast, volume 3, issue number 163. I'm Vin, sitting here with Matt.
Hello, everyone.
And the technical difficulties of Nick.
Hello, everybody. I'm here.
For the show, we spent about a half hour trying to figure out why Nick's Google Hangouts was not working.
It was just odd. So I went back into Mozilla Firefox and everything works fine. I don't get it.
Your computer does not like Chrome for some reason today.
I guess not. Just not today.
Nope. No matter. Anyway, we have a great show this week. So unless we have anything that we've been doing, we haven't really produced a show in a little while because we had some website problems and there's no point in recording a show if we couldn't put a show up. So
yeah, that's true.
Matt, like, put his teeth to the grind, or is that, no, is it, you know,
nose to the grindstone.
His nose to the grindstone.
Yes.
Nose, whatever, to the grindstone, and he got it back up and fixed. Still have a little minor thing to adjust, but it's up and running as far as people who want to download and listen are concerned. Apparently, we blew our bandwidth with the iTunes highlight.
Yeah. Yeah, there was one day awesome. We did, normally over the course of the month, we do about, in traffic, about 18 to 19 gigabytes. Okay, respectable.
Wow.
Well, we did that when I looked at our stats in one day, and it blew up our hosting. And they were like, no more hosting for you until the next bill cycle. So it's like, we need new hosting. And then there was some DNS issues with the domain RFIpodcast.com that had to do some domain forwarding and whatnot to get that worked out. But it's functional right now, so that's all that matters.
Yeah. But it's cool to see that we usually do quite a bit of bandwidth per month, but we blew that entire bandwidth in one day, which is also, I find, kind of odd that we had a bandwidth cap on our site, which none of the rest of my other sites have bandwidth caps. So I don't know.
It's pretty amazing, though.
Yeah.
I think that was when Jason was controlling the site. He didn't expect us to be doing more than a certain amount of gigabytes per month. And and they suggested, 20, I guess, was the cap. And they're like, nah, you'll never probably bounce that. And that's quite a bit, a lot, actually. But apparently we did close to that every month. So
right.
Wow.
Yeah, we were close to hitting the cap every month for a while. We were flirting with it. And then this is the first time we actually blew past it. We got highlighted, and next thing you know, no website for you.
What happens when you get in the
no top? Website for you? 2 weeks. Come back.
Oh. Yeah. So anyway, maybe we're going to jump right into our show this week. Or what do you think, guys?
I say let's
do it. I guess so, unless you had some gaming news to share.
Nah, not really. I've been working on some things for Far and Away, for Far Away RPGs. Far Away Land RPG, but that's about it. Nothing to be in the first. I know how people don't like that, so I won't talk about it.
Yeah.
The only thing I got is Origins this past, what was it, week, 2 weeks ago, they finally put up their events schedule.
Yeah,
right. And registered,
which is actually early for Origins.
I know they released it on April 15th. I was like, wow. And of course, as soon as I get on 1 o'clock, it like crashed.
Of course.
So that was fun. I got in like 5 minutes later, and I was able to register. I think for practically everything I wanted to, just to kind of let everybody know out there again at Origins, Wizards is sponsoring a couple of classic adventures again. And one of them was part of the A series, the Slave Lord series. Mm-hmm. And I don't know why they're just running this, the third part, A3, the Area of the Slave Lords, but they are. So I guess, because I remember who ran it last year, they used the reprints. for the S series. And I guess they chose this one. They thought this would be this section would be the most fun out of the Slave Lords one. So I'm like, that's cool. So they're running Module 83, the Area of the Slave Lords, and Module S3, Expedition to the Barrier Peaks.
Ooh. Oh boy.
So that's going to be way cool. So I got both of them. I'm like, yes. I'm actually going to play through Expedition to the Barrier Peaks.
Well, and I know North Texas RPG Con, they threw up their they're becoming just as bad as Gen Con as far as trying to get into a game now.
Really?
Yeah, it's like kind of like that whole thing. You have to be there at midnight just to get in the game that you want to get into.
Wow. Yeah, I think I got into everything but one game, and I found a great alternate. I'm going to be doing, an X-Wing miniatures game.
Okay.
Got into a couple Star Wars games, Call of Cthulhu, of course. So it's going to be really good this year. It's going to be really fun. So
good times. Yeah.
Looking forward to it.
Yeah, a couple weeks ago, me and my gaming group, we had our annual cabin con where we go down to General Butler State Park in Kentucky, rent a cabin, and just board game all weekend. So we had lots of...
How'd that go?
Oh, it went great, as always. Good times. We had... we actually keep official records from every year.
Huh.
So we have records going back to our first one in 2012, so we can keep track of who won what. Because we care about that type of things, because we are gamers and competitive. I ended up having to miss the first night due to we had the Northern Wrestling Federation, the wrestling promotion I work for, had a big wrestling show at Bogart's in Cincinnati, a concert venue that drew like 600 some people to. We had wrestlers from TNA, New Japan on the show, and that was a good time. But that meant I had to miss the first day of Cabin Con because we usually start Friday evening. So I head down Saturday and we get in a bunch of board games, played Cosmic Encounters, the Battlestar Galactica board game, the X-Wing miniatures, busted out cool. some Avalon Hill auto racing. We do that. That's something we do every year. Zombie Side, played that. So did some of the D&D Attack Wing. It's basically X-Wing, but with dragons. So that was fun.
Okay.
Yeah, it uses the same basic mechanics as the X-Wing miniatures game, except it's dragons, and you can cast spells and breathe fire.
Sweet.
So, yeah, it's fun times. Some Star Flux, Cards Against Humanity, a lot of quick games of One Night, which is basically plays like Werewolf, except with more types of villagers. So lots of gaming, lots of fun, and we are already planning to do it again next year around the same time. So in the same cabin, because we get like seven of us into one cabin, and it's a good time. Good time. So,
no guy with wielding a machete or a chainsaw going around killing you one by one?
No, but because we don't actually leave the cabin.
You guys are smart about it.
Right. It's only when you wander off by yourself into the woods you get hacked up. If you stay in a massive group, they doesn't attack.
Oh, that's how that works. Okay.
Right. And plus there, we would probably run across and get haunted by the ghost of General Butler. So.
Yeah. Well,
yeah.
And he's rather benign.
Right, and it was kind of disturbing when we noticed there actually was just one cabin over in between the two cabins was some gravestones, just fenced off.
Huh. Like,
what? Then we go and look at the gravestones, and they have no dates on them, and they look new.
Weird.
Yes, and this is a state park. That's weird. So someone apparently pre-bought plots in a state park.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, that's a little bizarre.
Yes, it was. We were just kind of like, what the? But anyway, as this is not This Week in Gravestones, let's go ahead and move on to our topic this week and head into Table Manners.
Yeah, so This Week in Gravestone. Oh, sorry.
What's the grace? Right. There might be a podcast for that, for all we know.
There's a podcast for everything. So there's probably some mortuary science podcast out there this week in Greece.
Probably.
This podcast is brought to you in part by a not very generous grant from Lesser Gnome, publisher of quality role-playing games since last year. Gnomes value high-minded programming just like you. Learn more at their website at www.lessergnome.com.
Typical. Of all the evil creatures in the world, I'd like to find one with table manners.
What, are you kidding me? I spent years cultivating the worst table manners on the planet.
Table manners.
Okay. In table manners... this week, I just thought we kind of do something about the OSR, the old school Renaissance, and because we've kind of expanded the podcast a little bit, talking about some of the OSR products in the past year or so. So I thought it'd be a really cool idea to get everybody up to speed out there who listens to the podcast about, you know, where the OSR started, give you a little bit of history, what's out there, and, you know, stuff that you can adapt to your AD&D game if you want to. There's such a wide amount of material out there. So I'll just give a brief history of kind of maybe where it started. This is not like an official history or anything. This is kind of like my view, maybe where this all started and where it's at today, and then go over some of the stuff that's out there now and what would be up to your, what would be to your liking. And so Matt will have a whole bunch of links to all these different places coming out of our show notes. So
poor Matt,
they're all links right there in the show notes. Yeah. So it's going to be easy. It's copy paste. I mean, how hard could it be?
You would be surprised,
right, Matt?
You would be surprised.
Okay. Excuse me. So let's kind of give this a brush over from like the history and maybe where this all started. And you could probably, you know, think back, being around 1999, let's get in our Wayback Machine. And I know right around there, the website dragonsfoot.org started. And it was more of like a private website. And then it became public. And there was other fan websites devoted to AD&D that were becoming more prominent then, particularly after TSR got bought up by Wizards of the Coast and they weren't so strict on a lot of the fan websites.
Towards the end there, they started $R.
Yes.
Yeah. Started not really caring at that point because people stopped buying everything they had. I mean,
yeah,
people that bought stuff, but people were so pissed at TSR at that point for taking anything down, like homemade stuff, people sharing games. They're like, boom, take down, boom, take down, take down. People were just like, you know what? Screw it. I'm not going to bother.
That was like, yeah, particularly in the early years of the, you know, when the internet. But it seemed like after that, Wizards of the Coast bought TSR, and even before that, there was kind of a slowdown because, you know, everybody was into the card collecting game craze of, you know, of Magic the Gathering. You know, D&D just kind of went by the wayside for a while. But then you get back, you know, up to year 2000. And they had to release a third edition D&D. And two of the big things that really helped the OSR movement begin was the Open Gaming License, the OGL, and the System Reference Document, the SRD. And that really opened things up for other publishers to take that third edition game mechanic and modify it, twist it. Sorry, Miley Cyrus. No twerking. Sorry. You know, kind of twist it around a little bit and make it really something to their own. That really comes on later on. But there seemed to be, and I know I was part of this, a vocal minority of people that really didn't like the new system. They gave it a try, but they didn't like it. I was one of them. I was really disappointed with the new system, and you started to hear rumblings on the internet from people about how much they didn't, some people, how they didn't like third edition. So there started to come like this kind of a retro movement, and one of those companies that wanted to buy into that, I guess you might want to say, is Necromancer Games. Necromancer Games started a whole module series that were kind of, their caption was third edition rules, first edition feel. So yeah, Necromancer Games producing those, and also Goodman Games too. They started to do their Dungeon Crawl Classics line of modules, which are fantastic. If you hadn't gotten them, they're still out there. I know you can find them at Troll and Toad and other places. And they started to do something similar that Necromancer Games did. They did all these different modules using the third edition game mechanic, but they were designed in a way they were like first edition AD&D modules. So there kind of was this, amongst some of the publishers, maybe some of the individual people out there on individuals who want to design stuff on the internet, that they wanted to do something kind of a retro feel. And this kind of started, you started to see a lot of that around this time and in the ongoing years. Then you look 1 year later, in the year 2001, and in my opinion, I think this is where the OSR movement really started to kick off with Kinzer and Company's release of Hackmaster. And why that was important is because Kinzer and Company worked out with Wizards of the Coast that basically they can use the advanced D&D game system, the game engine, for their Hackmaster game. It essentially, at its core, is first edition with some second edition and stuff, and some other little crunchy bits, kind of like with Rollmaster, with particularly the crits and fumbles tables. So, and there was all the whole thing behind it was, you know, it was old school gaming. And in fact, when you would look on the back of the player's handbook for the Hackmaster game that came out at that time, it says old school gaming. Who's watching your back? So I think probably would have been the first time you would have seen the tagline old school gaming with a gaming product. And they were able to re-release some of the old modules and everything. But the little caveat to that was part of their agreement is they had to have parity elements within the game, within the modules and stuff. That parity meaning, you know, it had to have little funny elements and stuff and the little tongue-in-cheek humor, some black humor here and there, you know. So some people were kind of turned off by that. For me, I thought that was a really cool angle, that they were still able to have basically first or even some second edition stuff that was released under the Hackmaster banner for Kinzer Co. And it got a lot of mileage out of that. In fact, I think that very next year, or it might have been that year, that Origins, that Hackmaster won Game of the Year award. Under much controversy, because after that year, then they redid the award system for like best role-playing game of the year, best board game of the year. They did away with the best game of the year award after Hackmaster won it. So I'm wondering what that says about things, you know?
Yeah. Well, the Origins Awards are also
they happen in
popularity contest. So... So
I just remember seeing the video of who presented the award for Game of the Year. Know who it was?
Who?
John Rhys Davies. He was there that year.
Wow. Jeez.
And the winner for Game of the Year is Hackmaster. You hear that, you're like, yes. That was so cool. So you have, like, within a matter of almost like months and a year, already people doing fan-based stuff based off the fan-based websites. You got Necromancer Games and Goodman Games doing their module lines there, kind of like first edition modules, but using the third edition engine. And then you have Hackmaster comes out, which was under license from Wizards of the Coast that they could do it. So you have all that going on. So you move on ahead to like 2004. And then Trollord Games comes out with Castles and Crusades. And this, I think, also gave everybody an idea of what you could do with the OGL and how much you can modify it. They actually took that third edition game mechanic and simplified it enough to a way to where it was almost mimicking, it almost mimics first edition AD&D in a way.
Wasn't this also when the court case came out about how you can't copyright game mechanics or something?
Well, that actually goes back older, I thought. The ruling
I
on
think
the,
that was went back longer.
Yeah, that went back longer. Because you cannot copyright a game mechanic, but you can copyright like the charts.
Yeah.
And
for some reason.
Right. Just to muddle things up, you can also patent game mechanics. Like there is a patent for Magic the Gathering that I think expires this year or next year. So the concept of turning a card sideways is actually patented.
You could patent this stuff because because it's intellectual property, right?
No, it's IP. It's because intellectual property is a broad term. It could also encompasses copyrights, trademarks. A patent is intellectual property. That's more of like an umbrella. A patent is something more of a procedure. I think that's the best way to say it. Patent is more
procedure
of like
procedure or the actual device, right?
Right. You can like actually go and search the government websites for patents and find patents for games. Like there's a patent for the HeroClix, like the bases they use. There's a patent on that. There is a patent
for Magic the actual mechanical part.
Yes.
There's a patent monopoly. I know that.
Right. So there's most of it has to come up with novel concepts for procedures for doing something. And that includes also the procedures of like creating like an physical object or something. And those only last about 20 years. Mm-hmm. Whereas a copyright, whereas if you were to create like
lasts a long time,
It's like 75 years after death of the creator. But if you can continue creating variants and you can basically extend it to in perpetuity, the way it's currently set up for anything created after 1978, I believe, because I think there was a big reform of copyright.
Well,
law.
There was like. Yeah, there was a whole thing that happened, like everybody kept on mentioning, well, the copyright on Mickey Mouse is going to be up in a few years. Like, Disney is ever going to let that go.
No.
All they have to do is renew the copyright, if I recall.
Well, no, it's not necessarily that. What they did is they kept getting the copy – petitioning Congress to extend the copyright law, them, Warner Brothers, and other media companies. Then they just realized, we just trademarked the characters and we don't have to worry about it. We don't. So
right.
They screwed up copyright.
If they're a trademark, then
A trademark you renew. That is how Gygax Games was able to get TSR. They got the copy. Mm-hmm. The trademark for TSR was expired, so they founded TSR Games, and you can't say there's market confusion because the trademark was expired.
Right.
But basically, U.S. copyright law got screwed up because until they realized they could just trademark their characters, they were extending copyright law to protect their characters. There was a point in time where some of the original Looney Tunes cartoons did hit public domain briefly because of a lapse in copyright laws. That got fit. That little loophole got plugged, much like It's a Wonderful Life. How it used to be shown on every television station come Christmas time because it was in public domain. Then someone realized there was a piece of music in it that was still in copyright. And all of a sudden, you only get to watch it on Turner. On TBS, so. Yeah. But anyways, it's not This Week in Copyright Law, because we can go down an entire rabbit hole of copyright and gaming.
Oh, yeah. Oh, my God. But I remember when Castles and Crusades came out by Troll Lord Games, one of the big things about that game, besides how the game mechanic was modified using the open game license and all that, is Gary Gygax officially got on board with Troll Lord Games to release more material. And that really gave Castles and Crusades a lot of momentum. And it's built up quite a bit of following. And it's a pretty good game in its own right. I got a few of the rule books, and it's a very good game.
There's quite a few here at the local bookstore here, the Recycle Books in Denton. You can find about a couple editions of it on the shelf in various modules.
Yeah, it's very well written stuff. It's very cool. I highly recommend Castles and Crusades.
And Mike Stewart of Save or Die had his hand in doing some things for them too. So
yeah, and I could say without a doubt that they had some wonderful booth babes whenever I go over there. So, oh yeah, chainmail bikini and everything. Aww. But moving on. So you have a game like Troll Lord's Games, Castles and Crusades, where they showed how they could take that, the OGL license and the source and the SRD, and say, you know what, this is how far you can modify it. Well, now then you go up a couple of years to around 2006, and you have Osric that comes out, which in all respects is like first edition AD&D, but they were able to release it under the open gaming license because they modified it even that much more to make it almost look like perfectly like first edition AD&D. And this was probably like the first real retro clone that kind of was out there, and it's free. Mm-hmm. You know, you could get the PDF for free, or you could go, I think you could go to Lulu and you could get either hardback or paperback versions of it. So you had Osric that came out in 2006. And after that, I would say from 2006 onward, it just kind of exploded for all the different many retro clones that came out, you know. And we're going to talk about some of these. Labyrinth Lord, you have Lamentations of the Flaming Princess, BX Companion, all these other ones that came out after that. And there's... It just exploded after 2006 with everybody trying to emulate something from the past, either like original D&D, the Holmes edition, Metzer edition, first edition, whatever, and everybody having their little twist on it. So the OSR just kind of exploded from there outwards. And what happened from there? Well, you had the death of Gary Gygax in 2008, but the year after, you had GaryCon in 2009, which was like at the first gaming convention really devoted to old school gaming. So there was now even a gaming convention kind of devoted to it. And now it's what, 6 years now for GaryCon right now.
Yeah.
And even got a little, wink and a nod on the show, Big Bang Theory, not too long ago. So, which was kind of cool.
Yeah. Something
with all this happening, you had, you know, you had Wizards of the Coast. They're like, what's going on here? They're kind of looking over their shoulder like, this is interesting. So, not too long after that, and I would say, I think it was 2012, 2013, that Wizards of the Coast released virtually the whole back TSR catalog on PDF. I think it was right around that time.
Yeah.
So that virtually everything, was re-released on PDF.
And then the premium reprints they came out with for first edition and second edition.
Yeah. Yeah, what's
that's right. Yeah. You had your first and second edition reprints.
Sadly, the sales did not I guess, add up to what they thought they were looking over their shoulder at, and they stopped.
Well, also you have to
look at... Well, the funny thing is, I don't think they really promoted it that much.
They put quite a bit into promoting it, actually. It just, they thought there was more into it. They looked over their shoulder, like, wow, the OSR is really blowing up. What they consider the OSR is blowing up. There's all these people protesting over the, you know, fourth edition at this point. All these people making up websites and games. Let's see what we, let's dip our toe in that water and see what happens. They released, they released these premium books that everybody looked at and went, meh. They're nice, but meh. I'm not paying $35 for a book that I already have on a piece of paper that doesn't look anything like I had.
Right.
And people bought them. Some people didn't buy them. And now you can buy them for like $10 on Amazon.
Yeah. I bought them. I bought the Unearthed Arcana one just for the simple fact my other one's falling apart. Yeah. So.
But with the release
of this premium. It does have the errata.
With the release of those premium, the release of the premium reprints too, though, you have to also consider the time period in which they release. There wasn't any other RPG products coming out from Wizards of the Coast. That is in that transition period from 4th to the current edition of D&D. So they needed some sort of cash flow, and that's when they really started hitting the back catalog. When I got to talk with the guys from Drive-Thru RPG at Origins back in 2011. And they, when I talked to them, they hinted about the D&D classics being released back in 2011. Mm-hmm. And it was like a year or so later when all the PDFs hit the market. So that is something that was that they started talking about and was pretty much a done deal back then in 2011 that all these PDFs were being released during that dark period of we're not really doing much with 4th because we know it's on the way out and we're taking what RPG resources we have and going to create the next edition of D&D. So I really think we got a lot of that OSR product, the reprints and whatnot, because they just needed something to get something out there to keep the D&D brand relevant during this transition period, unlike other transition periods of the past where it's like, here's all this product and now at the same time we have this new edition. Because I wasn't as into the gaming market when the transition from 2nd to 3rd, but there didn't seem to be that giant dead window when you went from 2nd to 3rd for product releases when compared to the window between 4th and next. So
yeah.
What's sad is that all those people that went to jail for pirating 4th edition when that was really such a failure of a line.
Well, the people that went got busted for the 4th edition, those were printer proofs. Those were internal leaks from somewhere. The copies were not someone taking a book and scanning it and releasing it. Those were pristine copies with markups that the printer was supposed to have and print out because it had the markings where to score them and how to put them in the book. So those were the original copies someone leaked out. So that's why they came down on them as hard as they did. Because those it would be the equivalent of getting the movie directly from the movie theater as opposed to sneaking your camera phone in and recording the movie. Those were pristine copies that got leaked before the books were released. Also, what I find interesting is when you look at the boom of OSR, it coincides with a couple things. One, that's about the target market, the people that grew up on D&D, were in their mid-30s. So all of a sudden, they have disposable income to be nostalgic. Also...
Yeah, actually, that's a very good point. You know, people like me, and you know, now we're in our 40s, but you know that when that market started to come out, now you got guys, you know, gamers that are getting into their 30s and into their 40s who were part of that, particularly, I would say, like that second wave of gamers that kind of started around like 1980, 79 on up to like 85. That wave of gamers where the popularity of D&D was just ginormous within that 5-6 years. So now we got those people growing up And like you said, they got disposable incomes now, and they got families, and they want to teach their kids. So it just kind of, yeah, it kind of snowballs from there.
Right. Also, the other thing that coincides with that as well was the commoditization of media. It became – everyone can be a publisher at that time. That's when broadband really started to penetrate well, when desktop publishing got really, really cheap and simple compared to what it is. And now – and it was easier to distribute your files. No longer back in like the 80s when you had to hop on a BBS to, if you wanted to share a file. Oh my God. Now,
if you were lucky,
right? If you were lucky, and that, or back in the dial-up days when you want to upload that PDF that's like 20 megabytes, you're going to have to wait a couple hours. You don't have to do that anymore. So, combine the disposable income from the people that grew up with it, so you have the nostalgia factor combined with the technology to make distribution and creation simpler. It opens the door for all these small publishers that a lot of the current OS, a lot of this wave of OSR product, you couldn't get away with doing print runs that weren't print on demand.
Right.
You could not. I mean, you have your Troll Lord games and those types. They have enough of a base that they can actually print hard copies, have it sent out to like Alliance and distributed to the stores. But a lot of these publishers that we're going to talk about later, they couldn't do. They can't necessarily follow that same. Especially when they first start out. So I think between the tech and the timing of the age of the market for it, you had this perfect maelstrom that that really spawned the OSR movement, that put it over the top from just being this niche product to something more mainstreamish in the gaming community.
Yeah. And now you're at a point, I would say – now in 2015, where it's culminated to, it still is a niche market within the niche market, you know, the gaming industry being a niche market in itself, but it's become significant enough where you see at gaming conventions like Origins and Gen Con, where there are quite a few of these games that are being played. I mean, like I said, this is like, I think the second or third year now where you're going to have some of these old TSR modules that are being run by people who represent Wizards of the Coast who are there. You can play in them. And I think even goes beyond that. Now I remember looking at the Origin schedule. There are people running things under the old Marvel Super Heroes role-playing game. There's a couple of games of that. Paranoia. Oh, my God. Star Wars D6 is still huge. There's actually a whole gaming community where – what's their name? Sparks?
Yes, Sparks.
And they run – all 5 days they run Star Wars D6 original D6 adventures. So it's gotten a lot of it's becoming a little more prominent, I would say, in the gaming industry. I think, at least in my opinion, I think the gaming conventions are a good barometer of how much more prominent has become in the past few years. And I think that's a really cool thing for me because there's room for everybody, you know. If you want to play old school, you want to play some of the newer stuff, you know, there's something for everybody. You don't have to ostracize people for whatever games they want to play. Right. You know, there's always got to be something there for something for somebody. So at least that's how I see it. So that's a little bit on the history. But kind of going beyond that, it's like, so what's out there? You know, what's out there in the OSR community that if you wanted to play something or if you just borrow information and material from, what can you do? Well, there's a lot of different ways to do that because there's so many different versions of D&D out there in the past. It's like there's people they've emulated certain versions of the D&D game, and you can start with original D&D, I would say, And from what I've seen, probably the most popular one that emulates original D&D is Swords and Wizardry by Mythmere Games. And I have a copy of that, which, you know, it's free to download, or you could buy copies, I think, on Lulu, or they have their own publishing. You can, you know, you could get a hardback version of it, maybe, or softbound. And Swords and Wizardry is a great way of going way back in the Wayback Machine and seeing how it was done back in like 1974 when D&D was first released. So Swords and Wizardry basically took all those rules and put them under one book, and modified them in a way to where they're easy. It's easy to read. You don't have to go all through different places and try to figure out where everything was coming from. So I'm a real big fan of that game, because if I ever was going to do something super old school, Swords and Wizardry is probably my go-to place. So that's a really good one. So Swords and Wizardry by Mythmere. So
they went and did the white box too to emulate the original.
That's right. That's right. And thank you for mentioning that.
Yeah, I've teamed up with, remember Fitz, who we had on the show here a while back with his Doors product?
Yes, yes.
I've teamed up with him, and we released a bunch of modules for the White Box. Serpents Below and Snake's Heart were the first two. We're releasing a third one real soon. It's really cool to write up modules for White Box because it's very simple, the system itself.
Yeah, and I think those White Box rules are great for if you want to introduce your – if you got kids and you want to introduce them to D&D, I think the white box rules like that Swords and Wizardry have is an excellent way to introduce them into the game. It's very simple.
Yeah.
And then you can, and then as it goes on, if you want to introduce more complex elements, you can, and it's because it's so easy to do. So James, yeah, I forgot about that.
And James Spahn released like 100,000 things in the last 20 minutes that we've been speaking. So
he's been a busy beaver.
James is a great guy. He released so many products in so little amount of time, and they just blew up, and he produces some good stuff. So just check out his stuff, Drive-Thru RPG. There's a lot of stuff for Sword and Wizardry White Box.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, a lot of the stuff you can find either on, like for Mythmere Games, you can find it on their website, or you go to Drive-Thru RPG, and you can find a lot of this stuff. So that's like the one that really emulates original D&D, the 1974 little booklets.
There was a little thing that Matt Finch dropped on his blog. I don't know if you saw it, Nick. Not his blog, Sword and Wizardry blog, that he was going to be giving titles and knighthoods out at North Texas RPG Conference.
Oh, really?
Yeah, for the people that have been producing and putting things out for Sword and Wizardry all this time as a reward.
So are you going to get knighted?
Maybe, I don't know. You didn't say.
Oh, that would be cool. Yeah, Sir Vincent.
Yes.
Awesome. So you got the original D&D emulator. So then you kind of move on from there, like in the history of the D&D game. You got, you know, either Holmes or the Moldvay rules, which probably the three of us are really familiar with. That's the one I kind of cut my teeth on. Or you got Metzger or Rules Encyclopedia. So those are kind of all put together in one way to emulate. And there's one called the BX Companion that was put up by a guy on his website, BX Black Razor. And I know you can find this on Lulu. You can download this or you can either download a PDF version of it, or you can get a print version of BX Companion. And I remember when he was promoting this back in like 2010, 2011, where essentially he took the idea of like, what would have happened if we all remember how we had the basic and expert rules for Moldvay, and they were talking about like there was a Masters edition that was supposed to come out. And within 2 years we had, you know, we had the Metzger edition, but, he kind of went to where, what if the Metzger edition didn't happen? What if it went on with the Moldvay style rules and all the other stuff came out after that? So that's what BX Companion kind of emulates, like almost a what if, where if those rules didn't you know, get revamped into Metzer. And I've seen it, and it's a really cool product. It's a really cool thing to have. He even does the artwork, like the front of it is somewhat of a it's a homage to the original, the books for Moldvay. But I would say, after that, the more popular one that emulates either Metzer or Moldvay rules is Labyrinth Lord by Goblinoid Games. I love Labyrinth Lord too. They did a really good job, in my opinion, on taking those rules. And by the way, letting everybody know out there, everything I'm talking about here, everything done out there, this is perfectly legal because it's done under the OGL. So, because you'll see in all these rules and stuff, you know, the very last page is a print, one or two page print of the open gaming license. And this is why these companies or individuals can do these sorts of things. So you have Labyrinth Lord, the Goblinoid Games, and it's an excellent version of, you know, 81 basic expert rules D&D. And I highly recommend getting that. You can download a free version of that too, or you can get print of Labyrinth Lord. After that, though, there's one out there that's gotten a, at least in the OSR community, that's gotten some, I don't know, I would say press, but it's gotten some attention, Lamentations of the Flaming Princess. Because it's very, very weird, from what I understand. I don't know if you're familiar with it, Vince or Matt, Lamentations of the Flaming Princess. I haven't seen the rules for them. I've seen, like, the cover of the rule book. But from what I understand, it's kind of like BX rules mixed with weird fantasy, Lovecraftian horror.
Yeah, with some adult themes thrown in as well.
Oh, yeah, with a lot of adult themes thrown in. If you go on Drive-Thru RPG, there's a few adventures written for Lamentations, of Flaming Princess. And some of this stuff is just very twisted. I mean, but if you enjoy that sort of thing, fine. Right. Go for it. Right. Me, not so much. But so you got those. And these are just a few examples, everybody, about some of the stuff what they're trying to emulate. I'm sure there are plenty of others. I'm just kind of picking and choosing probably some of the more popular ones out there. So you have those that kind of emulate your Metzer or Moldvay editions of D&D. Then we go on to first edition AD&D. And one of those, again, is Goblinoid Games. They did an advanced edition compendium for Labyrinth Lord. So basically you could take your Labyrinth Lord rule set and kick it up a notch to essentially emulate AD&D first edition.
Yeah, which we reviewed.
So you have that. Yeah, which we did review, and it's a really cool product. And again, you can download a free PDF version of that, I believe. And most of these, I got to let everybody know, if you get most of these, if they're free PDF versions, it's generally without the artwork. It's just the rules and the tables. But I think, most of them who are free PDFs, they don't have the artwork, which is, you know, neither here nor there. But just to let you know why some of those are free as well. And then we have the aforementioned OZERT, the old school reference and index compilation that was put out there by then. It was like a group effort from Knight and Knaves Ale House, if I recall. So you have that emulates first edition. Then you got a plethora of other retro clones. And one of my favorites is Adventures Dark and Deep by BRW Games, which you can find on Drive-Thru RPG. And that we talked about, I think I talked about before. It's like, what if, you know, E. Gary Gygax, the man, got to write, you know, second edition AD&D? You know, what if he stayed on to TSR from 1985 and what his version of? I love this game. I think Joseph Block did an excellent job on his homework on this game. through all the different Dragon magazine articles, you know, and picking out those nuggets of information is like what Gary hinted at he was going to put in his game.
Yeah, so just, I thought that by saying that this is Joe's version of what he thinks Gary would have done.
Right. Yes. But a little caveat to that.
We don't know what Gary would have done, but this is what he believes Gary would have done.
Oh yeah. And in my opinion, I think he did a really good job of guessing what Gary would have done. So, you know, Adventures Dark and Deep is a really good, really cool game system. Then you have Basic Fantasy Role Playing, which does essentially use the D20 system, but it's heavily modified to kind of emulate the 1980s RPG style. And I believe you could get that for free too, Basic Fantasy Role Playing.
Yeah,
I believe you could get that free PDF. Then I talked about Castles and Crusades earlier, and then another one, which was done, I would say 2010, 2011, by Goodman Games, is their game called Dungeon Crawl Classics. Now, they had the Dungeon Crawl Classics lines of modules, but when 4th edition came out, I know Joe Goodman and the rest of the crew there, great guys, by the way, they used for their inspiration for their game, Dungeon Crawl Classics, they looked at Appendix N in the original AD&D Dungeon Master's Guide. And just to remind everybody, Appendix N was the recommended reading guide that Gary Gygax had if you were going to play the game, and basically used that as their inspiration for the game. It's essentially the D20 system at its core, but modified enough to where you could see how Appendix N heavily influenced the Dungeon Crawl Classics game. Particularly the Jack Vance books, the Lovecraftian stuff, so that's a very interesting game. Some people like it, some people don't, because of the starting character funnel system.
Yeah,
it could be. Some people aren't big fans of it. You don't have to play it that way. I thought that was cool. I love how they do magic in the system, because when you use magic in the Dungeon Crawl Classics game, there is a price to pay. Your magic user starts to mutate and stuff. So
yeah, and also with Dungeon Crawl Classics, part of the reason I think it also spawned out is because when they went from 3rd to 4th, they went away from the OGL. They created the game system license, which was far more restrictive. I think there was even a clause in, if they decided they wanted you to pull your product from market, they could tell you to do so if it was under the GSL. I mean, it was very draconian when compared to the OGL. So third-party publishers like Goodman Games, they wanted to publish at least the impression that I got was for a game that was in print. So they wanted to, because I think they even released a couple 4th edition modules or.
Oh, they have.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, they released some, but then they also at the same time were working on their own game system, because at that point you're too beholden to Wizards of the Coast under the GSL. Yes. So I think that the GSL in a way actually spawned a lot more of the creativity in the OSR community, because a lot of the stuff under the OGL was horribly derivative. Because we didn't even touch on the RPG boom of the early 2000s that started, and the giant collapse that also coincided.
Oh yeah, the mountain of splat books that were produced by everybody and their brother.
Right. Yeah. Because it was just
that kind of.
Because that there was just. Everyone basically. Yeah. Everyone at some point, it seemed like, was publishing something under the OGL, because 3rd edition, particularly 3.5, was really popular. So the market became overly saturated with crappy supplements There was a supplement for any minutia you could think of, to the point where it was kind of reminiscent of the video game bust of the early 80s when the Atari market got flooded with so much crap. And again,
I think a real good gauge of that was when you went to game conventions. I remember there was so much swag given away at like Origins and Gen Con that was published books. You know, they were throwing in your swag bag because they weren't selling.
Right. Yeah, I remember there was one year at a Gen Con. I think I walked away with more free stuff than I spent on attending the convention. That's including hotel.
Oh, yeah. I mean, you could just walk down the aisles of Troll and Toad at either Gen Con or Origins, and you saw the deals like D20 products, like 5 for $20 or some insane amount.
Yeah.
And a lot of this stuff is hardback.
Right. There was one year at Gen Con, Troll and Toad had a booth. Everything in the booth was $5. Towards the end of the con, everything in the booth was $2.
Yeah.
So there was just a glut of product that was released, and I think the GSL was a way, much like, to go back to the video games comparison, in order to prevent that glut of publishing that the Atari had, Nintendo actually had a licensing system to be on the NES console. And I think the GSL was kind of a way for Wizards of the Coast to have that same licensing effect to prevent so much of the crap getting thrown out on the market and just destroying the RPG market like it did earlier.
Mm-hmm.
So, you're starting to see like a fractal.
But in a way, it kind of backfired on them too.
Yeah, it actually created a lot more competition. In a way, it made the hobby healthier, because everything wasn't so dependent upon piggybacking off one concept. Everything wasn't focused on the TSR universe anymore. And this is what gave us Pathfinder and brought along a lot of other game systems. And I think we've seen more exploration in other mechanics other than D20-based systems. Thanks to the GSL.
I think some people can argue this, but wasn't it at one point that Pathfinder was more popular than 4th edition D&D? It was actually outselling it?
Yeah, that was outselling. That was a fact, not a rumor.
Okay. I thought so. And then what Matt was saying is like companies like Goodman Games with that new license, they saw it as something like, no, we're going to make our own game here now. And that's how the Dungeon Crawl Classics game kind of came to be. And they were using the old D20 mechanic. Now, old D20 mechanic. Wow. I never thought I'd say that. So there's a sampling of all the different types of games that emulate D&D out there, and there's plenty more. I just, like I said, touched on the more popular ones, and
had that big chart. I think it was 2 or 3, maybe.
Yeah,
the first one. I'm not sure. I had that big chart of all the games that branched out of other games, and it's a huge chart.
Yes, and that's actually a really good segue, Vince, into the next part: the magazines that are out there. Hey, it's like, wow, big surprise there, right? Yeah. So not only magazines, but also websites too, I guess. You can kind of fit those together. But now there's dedicated or mostly dedicated magazines to old school gaming. Nox Spell by Mythmere Games. They have their own game devoted to that. Fight On magazine, a great magazine that you can find out there on DriveThruRPG, is a great. What's that?
Fight On, a magazine that's no longer produced.
I don't know.
I thought it was gone. I don't remember seeing any new issues, but I could be wrong.
Yeah, it might be one of those magazines where it just goes, has a spurt a few issues and it goes away. But I know you can still find them in Drive Through RPG.
Yeah, the last issue was
there's
from
a free
2013. Yeah. So
that's what I thought. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And you can still get them there. They're still great resources.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, the e-zine by dragonsfoot.org footprints. There's another one. Well, I have a hard time pronouncing this. Obulet, yeah. I guess it would be. Obulet.
Yep.
By Gold Piece Publications.
Yeah.
That's another old school gaming magazine.
Yeah, primarily for Labyrinth
Lord. And I think
that
one's still going strong.
Yeah, that one's primarily for Labyrinth Lord focus, but no, it's a great e-zine that you could steal for any game system, really.
Yeah. And then we had what we were talking about just a minute ago, Gygax Magazine, which was started by our own DM Jason.
Yeah. Yeah. And we don't feel
that's been going.
We have N Magazine. What's that? N Magazine dedicated to first edition.
Yep.
Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, N Magazine, too. How could I forget those guys? My goodness.
We have Old School Quarterly. That's going to be coming out real soon. And by Jason Jason Paul McCartney, his last name is. I apologize if I got that wrong, but he does the OSR Today website, which is a news website for OSR related material.
Yep, OSR Today.
Mm-hmm. And
so there is a plethora of material out there.
Yes.
Dungeon Crawl Classics have their own magazine as well that comes out. But there was one that was a mix between OSR and 5th edition that Venger does. I think it's called Draconic Magazine.
Mm-hmm.
But it's an e-zine, only online.
Okay.
So that's the ones I could think of offhand.
Yeah. I almost forgot Anne Magazine. How could I forget? I mean, we had those guys on. So, sorry. We'll add it to the show notes. We'll add them to the show notes. Don't worry.
And then there's also Crusader Magazine for Castles and Crusades.
That's right. Crusader Magazine. Is that still going strong?
Let's see. I'm pulling it up.
I saw them in North Texas last year. At least the guy had them out.
Okay. Yeah.
I know Trollord's still going on. I didn't know their magazine Crusader was still going, though.
Yeah, because they're up to they have 26 issues up on their website.
Oh. Well, there you go. So,
and I want to qualify Gygax Magazine under the OSR. They do print OSR stuff, but it's not an OSR.
Right.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah. It's not totally devoted to it, but it's got some good material in there regardless.
It's more meant to be like the modern day Dragon Magazine, which means supporting all games in and out of print. That's the way to look at it, because there's a whole section for Kobold Quarterly actually got rolled into Gygax Magazine with Wolfgang Bauer writing a section. Yeah. So it's not a straight OSR magazine, but because of the name Gygax, people automatically think OSR. So
it's like the mag for old and new.
Right. It's the modern day equivalent of Dragon.
Yep. Which we've been needing for a long time.
Yes.
So that's pretty much, at least how I see it, the OSR community, past, present, and future. Well, what's the future going to hold? I don't know, Matt, guys, speculations on what maybe the future of the OSR community might hold?
I'm wondering at what point does it stop being its own segment of the community and just part of the greater community? At what point does the OSR become popular enough that it's just considered gaming anymore as opposed to like a subsection? Or will it always have that division of, oh, this is just for people that like old stuff? Or will at some point it will just be considered if you play old games or new games in print, out of print, you're just gaming?
That's starting to happen, you know.
Yeah.
But you know, I agree. Maybe it's just it should become more of a part of just regular part of the community in its own right.
Right.
I mean, what do you think, Vince? What do you think the future will hold?
The OSR really is just the way and the style of playing games. It's no longer just, hey, it's AD&D or, you know, basic D&D or anything. It's just a style of emulating the games that we played in the past, which is slowly just becoming modern gaming, because as 5th edition looks now for D&D, that's kind of what it's doing. It's right. telling you, hey, here are the rules, but you know what? If you want to play the rules like your father or like you played when you were a kid, here you go.
Right. Yeah.
You could almost think of it
What's
more...
What's old is new again.
Yeah. You could almost think of it as more of like a genre of gaming. It's a gaming style. Yeah. It's not a game. And once... Mm-hmm. But right now, I still think there's more of a focus on its specific games, not a style of play. Because I think you right. could have an OSR style of play in any game system. You can do that with any game system because it's mm-hmm. more certain themes that make it OSR, not the actual game itself that makes it OSR.
Right. It's not just, necessarily the mechanics. It's how you run it.
Right. And I think what we're going to eventually see is those themes that – and I think at some point OSR stops being games and it will become just a style of play. Like your
right.
comedy game, your high fantasy, your low fantasy, it'll just be another variant of that. I think that'll probably be better for the health. And I think because there are certain aspects of the parts of the community, I think, like having that segregation. There are the grumpy grognards, you could say, that are like, no, I'm not going to corrupt my games with any of this newfangled stuff. Urgh. And I think as those aspects of the community get dwindled, I think at that point it'll become more the community will become more homogenized into the existing gaming culture as those voices weaken. So, and then eventually we'll all be gaming along.
In one big happy family.
Yes. Wait a minute. We're gamers. That'll never happen.
we're gonna bicker and argue to our very last breath, right?
Exactly.
Oh, well. You know, you always have dissenters in every group. I know I was like that, too. It's like, but I've grown to a point now, it's like, you know what, we got room for everybody. You know, it's a big enough pond for all the fishes to swim in. And I mean, I just like a particular style, and you know what, if you like a particular style, that's cool too. And like you said, man, it's like more of a style thing, less of a game mechanic thing, which can factor into it though,
right?
But I think a real good way, again, for everybody who is want to know what we mean by like the styles, everything, is that one little what was that little booklet called, A Primer for Old School Gaming, that was put out just a few years ago. And that's a really good if you don't have it, I would recommend downloading it. I think you can find it at DriveThruRPG. I think it's free, so get that Primer for Old School Gaming. And if you want to introduce some of your friends to some what the style of play is like, that's the perfect way of going about it. And I know we've talked about it on the show too in the past about that primer. So again, you know, go to that. So
yeah, I wrote a really good article in Gygax Magazine. Sorry, I think it was two. How to get into old school gaming, which kind of took that primer and just bounced off more ideas for people to look at.
Mm-hmm.
So hopefully people can enjoy that as well.
Yeah. So I think I covered pretty much everything I wanted to on this, but let's move on with our little OSR thing, and we'll go on to our next segment, which is the creature feature.
Okay. Are you saying that I put an abnormal brain into a 7.5-foot long gorilla?
Creature Feature Theater.
It's alive!
Here's the creature feature. Matt, do you want to talk about our creature? Or?
Yes, we can talk about this creature because this is a creature from Labyrinth Lord. It is a spin on the Lanthrocorp. It is a demon boar.
Demon boar.
Yes. This is, it's basically you take your werebore, but make it more evil and malicious.
Evil.
Because this one, it delights in the taste of human meat. And it'll
hunt. Yes, it does.
Yes. So, and it'll take occupancy near human residences. In human form, they're fat and grotesque. So, and then boar form, they're immense. They are only, and like other Lanthrocorps, they're only damaged by magical and silver weapons. But, and what's interesting about them, though, they have this innate ability to charm 3 times per day. You get your saving throw.
Yes, charm person.
Yes, a charm person Lanthrocorp. The victims
yes.
get -2 saving throws. Also, when you encounter one, 75% chance of having 1d3 charmed human thralls with them.
Nice.
Yes. So
who are able to do what?
Yes. They're unable to use spells or spell-like devices due to
right.
the mental domination, but they will do whatever you can get charmed people to do. So the Demon Boar has their little minions. And then they also like to catch people by surprise. They're
yes.
just very nasty. You got your 9 hit dice. They
yeah.
They either do 2d6 when they gore you with their horns, or they hit you with a weapon. So yeah,
yep.
And they're chaotic, of course.
Yeah. Yes,
and they're kind of fast
so.
In boar form with the 180 movement. So
yeah, that's very fast.
Yes, they will chase you down and gore you, then charm you to be their little slave. So
yeah,
yeah, it's a nice little spin on the Lanthrocorp to basically just take that existing little it's a weird creature. Get your magic, get your silver. Let's go kill it too. Wait a minute, why does it have these humans with them? Do we kill them? Are
yeah.
they evil? Are they not? Or perhaps if you run a campaign where your player characters have family members, perhaps some of them become dominated by a demon boar. I mean, there's all kinds of little...
I could even... Oh, yeah, I could see these guys being... since they're like they're a variant of the werebore itself, I could also see these guys as like leaders of a werebore clan or something like that.
Right.
You know,
I'm actually
almost like how Flynns are like usually could be like leaders of gnolls. You can almost see them in that role too.
Right.
You know, as like leaders of a werebore clan group or whatever.
I'm also having visions of the movie Brotherhood of the Wolf, where the French village was tormented by this giant beast that they weren't even sure what it was. But as people go out into the woods, they just don't come back. And they find some all just eaten. They just find their eaten remains. And others come back, but you can tell something's wrong with them because they're charmed and luring other people out into the woods. So there's just... lots of stories that could be done with this. And the creature, it's not so foreign that when the players first encounter it, it's like they won't be like scratching their head, what is this? But it's that just those little few little extra abilities that it has that all of a sudden will have them doubting themselves after they encounter it.
Right. So, yeah, it'll little extra things that kind of like throw them for a loop. It's not your dad's lycanthrope, let me tell you that.
No, it's not.
So, no. And I chose this monster too because I thought, you know, I thought it was a unique creature I saw in the Labyrinth Lord rules, so I thought it would be a real good example of that. So there are When you look at a lot of the rules for some of these systems, you know, they do take some of the original monsters and modify them, or they make, you know, whole new monsters too. So I thought this was a real good example of that. So,
yeah. Yeah. This is
a
great example of taking an existing monster, putting a different spin on it, so it feels different. So that way, if you have the jaded players that have seen it all, done it all, this is a great example of how to make them feel, how to take what they know and turn it on its head to give them a completely different encounter. So,
yeah. Yep, and all 9 hit dice of it.
Yes, all 9 hit dice of I'm just envisioning if one of the players happened to get knocked unconscious into like 0 hit points or something, and then all of a sudden the boar stops attacking the other players and just starts munching on that the visual the other players would have. It's like, oh no, it's just feeding now. What do we do? And then you have the fun of trying to bring back a player who's lost an arm. So yeah, good stuff. And yeah, and this is just from page 71 of the Labyrinth Lord rules. So just download your copy of Labyrinth Lord, and you can find the stat block for it. So, and then many other creatures like
it. Yes, under D. So I think it's the very first one. Under D for demon. So I guess that will cover our creature from the creature feature. So I guess we'll move on to our Dragon's Horde section, and we'll talk about some cool things out of the Dragon's Horde.
You mean treasure chest?
Yes, because you see, we've
chest.
Yes, we've since freed all the treasure from the Dragon's Horde, and we now store it all in chest.
It's in the treasure chest. Ah, my bad.
Yes, we no longer have to fight the dragon every week to get our item we're talking about. We just opened the chest now. It got a lot simpler. We did lose a lot of our kobolds answering the phone hotline. But
they're a diamond.
Exactly. They're expendable. So, yes, we will move
on. So let's move on, I guess, to the treasure chest. Is that what it is?
Yes.
Okay.
You have opened the treasure chest. You may choose an item.
The treasure chest. So, I thought, looking at some of the magazines that are out there for the OSR, I looked at Fight On number 1, and they had a little section at the very end of the magazine, Artifacts, Adjuncts, and Oddments. So basically, a listing of different magic items that you can add to whatever campaign you're doing. So I don't know who would like to take the first one and talk about that.
Yes, there's some very interesting things. Like the first one is a harpy cloak. A cloak made from the skin and feathers of a harpy killed by deceitful means. Because when you wear this
Is there
cloak,
any other way?
Well, maybe if you did vanquished a harpy in a honorable battle, you get a different type of cloak. Because when you kill them via deceitful means, it allows the owner to charm others as per the first level spell. And it lasts as long as the cloak is worn. But however, the spite of the murdered harpy is not to be trifled with. And you take 1d3 hit points of damage each consecutive day it is worn. So, and no amount of washing can remove the slight fecal waif caked in the ragged feathers. So basically, you smell like poo when wearing this cloak.
Yay!
And you take 1d3 hit points of damage, but it does let you charm people, and they're charmed until you take the cloak off. So you're going to get pretty rank, considering unless you're bathing in the cloak as well. Yeah, and I'm sure once you do take it off, the person you charmed won't be happy.
So it's definitely a magic item with a not so, it has some uses, but it's got a not so great side effect.
Right. So. It's like, yeah, you get the charmed person and they're charmed as long as you wear the item. Great. But you smell like poo and you take damage every day you wear it. So eventually will kill you. Unless, of course, you charmed a cleric who heals you every day. At which point you just have your healing battery with you.
Right. Well, our next item, I guess I'll talk about this because I think this one's pretty cool. The Jug of Oozes. So the holder of this secret antediluvian jug can pour forth a random generated ooze. So the ooze takes 1d3 rounds to pour, or 2d6 rounds if it's a gelatinous cube is rolled. So you can pour out a gelatinous cube, which I thought was kind of cool. So there's a hidden curse to this, though. There's a 1% chance, cumulative chance, that the user or jug will be magically sucked into it after each ooze is poured, so as to feed it generating capability. So another nasty side effect. This sucking is very difficult to resist, and the percentage will only reset to 1 after something has been successfully sucked in. Anything taken into the jug will almost surely die. If you need the roll, treat a double damage for every kind of ooze the jug can generate each round with no to hit necessary. So a D6 roll, you can either get an ochre jelly, a black pudding, a green slime, gray ooze, yellow mold, or a gelatinous cube. So 1% cumulative chance every time you use it. You could get sucked into this thing to replenish it, basically. So
I
thought that was pretty cool. Yeah. I mean, it's got its uses. I mean, you might have a black pudding come out of there and start attacking your enemies, but each time you use it, well, you might get sucked into it and feed the beast.
Yes, and I'm actually having, since it's a pitcher, I'm envisioning if a player were to uncork it and look in, what would they see? Because I'm almost wondering, would a player be dumb enough to try to drink out of it?
Yes.
I never thought of that one.
Yes. So they go to take a drink out of the pitcher because it's obviously would be radiating magic, and they pour an ooze or a jelly on themselves.
That's just horrible.
Yeah,
I want to use that.
Yes, it must be used.
Tastes minty.
Yeah. Or perhaps you have just like the skeletal remains of someone next to the pitcher where they poured the ooze on themselves to give them a hint. Maybe you shouldn't drink from this.
Or you could be like in Alice in Wonderland, put the big put the drink me on it.
Yes, drink me. That'll go over.
Sure.
Great.
What happens if you drink the gelatinous cube?
Well.
Well.
Hilarity and comes out of that for one.
Yeah. You puff up like they. Willy Wonka, when she became the big blueberry, and you become like a big gelatinous cube or something?
Sure, why not?
Does it absorb you inside out?
Well, I don't know, because like you're trying to drink that, and I think what's going to eventually happen is like your head's going to explode.
Well, at least with the gelatinous cube, it takes 2d6 rounds to pour out. So the entire cube wouldn't be poured out, just part of it.
Maybe. I don't know, because what does gelatinous cube do? Its main attack is paralysis.
Yeah.
So as soon as it tucks you, you got to make a save. And if you're paralyzed, you're paralyzed in the pouring position. You're paralyzed in the pouring position. So it's going to pour all over your face and head and. I love it. That's great.
Yeah.
Probably fall over, Nick, unfortunately, when you start getting.
Oh, well. Still. At least for a few moments, you're going to be standing there and look like a doof.
Yeah.
I think we're going to have to we're gonna cap it off here this week and call the show this week. And we had a fun time doing this show with our history of the OSR. Thanks to Nick, the show writer this week, who gets credit.
Thank you.
And Nick will be our show writer from now on, apparently.
Oh, great. Well, as long as all my technology works.
Yeah. Now we'll be back in, for another show in a couple weeks. We do it every twice a month, this show now, on Sundays. So you can join us on Google Plus if you want to watch it live, or you can just wait for the podcast whenever they drop. We don't know anymore. Right, Matt?
Yes, we'll have one dropping very soon. The website issues set back the release of issue 162, so things got a little bit delayed, but now that all of our website issues are worked out, we should get in a more semi-regular release schedule.
So, absolutely.
And don't forget, if you want to get the shows a little early, go to our Patreon, and you can donate. Patreon.com/WGP. Kick a few ducats WGP, our way.
Yeah, you can throw a few bucks to get the show earlier. You can get our pre-show chat, which we talk about various things before the show, or listen to Nick screw up his technology.
Yes.
I don't know what happened.
Yes, Nick versus technology.
Technology fails me.
Listen to Matt's predictions about WrestleMania, not caring.
Yes, the apathy that reeks currently of WWE for me.
Yes. So we'll stay keep it original, keep it old school. Good night, everybody.
Good night.
Bye, everybody.
Podcast is a production of Wild Games Productions in association with d20radio.com. You can visit us at rfipodcast.com or contact us on our forums at osrgaming.org or even by calling us at 570-865-4210. This podcast is produced for entertainment purposes only. All other uses are prohibited. And remember, if your magic missile spell doesn't automatically hit, you're playing the wrong edition. Thanks for listening, and we'll see you next time on Roll for Initiative.